Hi everyone. Please take your seats. And we can settle down again. Sorry we're starting a little bit late. Today will be a little bit more relaxed than yesterday. We won't do so many blackboard calculation type things, but you'll get to see some nice pictures and some ideas of what we're doing. But before we get on to the second lecture, which if you recall was going to be about parameter estimation methods, so how do we actually do it in practice, I did want to take a few minutes to show you some of the results from the binary neutron star detection, GW170817, that we made last year. And hopefully now that you have a full understanding of what physics is driving these results, you can put all this in perspective. So I'll start off just by this beautiful slide. This is more or less the first thing that we saw looking at the spectrograms of the data. Unfortunately, there was a large glitch that has been excised, so it's a bit of a cosmetic alteration to this picture, but it does give you an idea of just how loud this thing is, because normally you would expect the power, instead of in a binary black hole system where it's concentrated in this narrow band of frequencies and a very short time, binary neutron stars extend for tens of seconds in the LIGO-sensitive band. So normally we actually were surprised to be able to see this in the data so clearly.
In that LIGO curve, is that about 45 seconds?
Yeah, I think that's right. Yeah, there's a bit of a debate about, you know, how long exactly was it in the band. Of course, it depends on where you start integrating. So the parameter estimation, it lasted around 100 seconds. It was the length of the analysis that we actually did for the data. Okay, so having done that analysis, we were able to look at the parameters. And the first thing to say is that just from the gravitational waves alone, at the earliest stages of detection, we couldn't be sure, of course, that it was definitely a binary neutron star that we'd seen, because all we really knew that it was two objects that had masses somewhere in this range, consistent with all the observed double neutron star systems in that we know about, which cluster up around here. So the evidence is, based on the mass estimates, that it's totally consistent with the population of double neutron stars, but we cannot tell directly just from the data at this early stage that that's really what it was. But what we would have to be able to do for that is to look at the matter effects, and we can say a bit about that, but we'll come back to that later. So if you remember yesterday, we were talking about the degeneracies between the different mass parameters and also between mass and the effective spin parameter. And this is especially important in this analysis because we actually went to the length of doing two separate analyses. One, assuming very little about what the spins could be, which gives you the very long red posterior distribution that you see here, and one that has a maximum a maximum line spin component of less than 0.05 of the Kerr parameter. Now, the reason for doing that is because we basically would expect that if this is a double neutron star like the ones that we know about, then it's not likely to be spinning much faster than that, because the ones that we know about in double neutron star systems in our galaxy have spin parameters less than 0.04 or so. So this is basically an astrophysically motivated prior on the spin parameter. But we present results both from that and from the less constrained possible binary black hole type prior in order to just illustrate the difference that it makes. And you know now that this makes a huge difference, because this reduction in the allowed spin space cuts off the degeneracy between spin and mass ratio and lets you constrain the mass ratio much more consistently. And when you do that, you find that indeed the mass ratio does move closer to 1:1. It could have been elsewhere, of course, somewhere along this red banana, but that is what we found. So that's, again, a good indication that if you make this assumption, it does look consistent with a double neutron star system. Was there a question? I heard some muttering. Nope.
For the spin
or for the...
I guess for the spin.
Well, the prior in the mass space, I probably should have said this yesterday, is actually flat in this diagram. But the prior in the spin space has that strange shape. But you can see that basically there is a tail that's been cut off that's giving you that better constraint. Pardon? The mass prior, well, we tune it based on the analysis we want to do, but generically speaking, it can be anywhere between one solar mass and 100 solar masses. Now, once you look at the data and see that there's a thing in there that's... that's before we decide to speed up the run by restricting the mass prior to something closer to 1 to 3. Although I think we actually went down below 1 because you can see here that there are values allowed here. So we basically found that the mass ratio is so poorly constrained that it is allowed to go to values that have something that's very heavy, you know, probably not a neutron star on one end, and something that's subsolar mass on the other end. So we had to then relax that in doing the analysis. So there is a sort of, you know, we look at the data and refine what we're doing along the way. So looking at this in the other picture, I can show you the same sort of constraints. This time we've got the mass ratio, that's M2 over M1 is what we call Q, and the chi effective parameter. So you can see what I'm saying is that this chi effective is allowed in the binary black hole model where we don't constrain it. The data does not constrain it all that strongly, but it does limit it at around 0.1-ish, rather than allowing it to go up to 0.89, which was the full extent that it could have been at. And then if you make this additional cutoff at 0.05, then you get this more constrained distribution. So there's also another more detailed analysis after the initial detection paper that's come out in this paper here. So if you've not been aware, there's a reanalysis with better waveform models. You can see there's a larger range of tidal waveforms that we're including in this paper compared to what we did in the first place. But they're all giving fairly consistent results in terms of the mass, at least when you include the small spin effect. Then we can look at the neutron star spins themselves. And the picture here, oh dear, I was going to say the picture is not so clear, and that is indeed the case. Yeah, here we go. It's fine. So if you look at, the chi effective and the chi p parameters, given the length of this template, we're now able to get a better constraint on chi effective than we were when we looked at the binary black holes. Again, from the length of the signal, the fact that you have far more cycles and you can sort of look at the higher order terms in a bit more detail. So if you look at the difference between the prior again here and the posterior in the binary black hole case, there is actually a fairly informative measurement coming from the data. The chi p parameter, you see that the story is still, this is more difficult to constrain. You do get some information out of the data, more than we had in the binary black hole cases, but again, it's still a difficult parameter to constrain. We need a high signal-to-noise ratio to measure those spin tilt angles very effectively. So we're looking at, in the future observing runs, this will be one of the things that we're most interested in. Okay. Yeah? Oh, that's a good question. Is there a correlation between chi p and chi effective in the prior? Well, there is. It's not so much a correlation, but there's a two-dimensional shape that it takes, which I can sort of sketch for you. I think it's in one of the slides from the last lecture, but I'm not going to go back and find it. But I can draw it roughly. Is that the prior looks something like this, where that's chi p, and that's chi effective. So we tend to make measurements of chi effective, and that corresponds to taking a slice through here. So if you think the data is sort of limiting the allowed values of chi effective somewhere in this region, then what you see in the chi p result is actually kind of due to the shape that this has in these parameters. Okay, so let me move on, because there's some additional parameters that come into the binary neutron star analysis that are particularly interesting that didn't come into the binary black holes at all. And as I said yesterday, that's just because binary black holes do not have any material properties that react to the gravitational field directly. So neutron stars themselves, they will feel the tidal field of each other, and the matter in the neutron star will be deformed to try and you know, minimize its potential surface, just the same way that the tides on the Earth in the ocean are raised by the moon. Except these tides have frequencies of tens or more hertz, and there's the amount of motion that's going on is, you know, many Earth masses, I expect. So we can add these parameters into our model. Actually, you want a model that kind of builds them in directly. This is still very much a work in progress. People who are working on waveforms will tell you that adding in tidal parameters in a consistent way is actually something that's still being worked on, and there's many different effects and many different couplings that have to be taken into account between the different moments of the matter distributions. But we can add them into our phenomenological waveforms, into our SEOB waveforms, or just into the point particle Taylor F2 waveform. That's the standard in-spiral waveform where we don't have the merger. And you can see, then, repeat the analysis to give you some idea of the range of the results representing the uncertainty due to the waveform. And just because the statistical errors are still pretty large, you find that most of these models give roughly the same type of result. But what you're able to do here, if you plot these lambda parameters, these are the tidal deformabilities of the two stars, lambda 1 and lambda 2. If you allow them to vary independently, then you can set a constraint on this joint parameter space that ends up pushing it downwards into one of the corners, into the lower values of lambda corners. And again, you can do the same analysis, allowing for the small spin or the large spin, and the results do change quite a bit because the mass is involved in the calculation of the lambda. Question? This is the updated one, so you can grab down the archive number from there. Not in this result. So I didn't put in the plot. We then go on to ask the question, well, you wouldn't expect the two neutron stars to have different equations of state. The equation of state should be universal, or at least it's a good assumption that it is. And in order to do that, you can then work out a posterior on that universal equation of state parameterized in a certain way. But the details are a little bit too complex to get into here. But this does bring up one of the issues that was raised yesterday about priors, because there's kind of a little bit of a pathology in this two parameterizations. Because you can see that the constraint is very much in this direction and not in the other direction. So if you're looking at just one of these, or if you want to reparameterize it, then you have to take into account the fact that the actual allowed range in the perpendicular direction is much smaller down in the corner than it is up here in the large values. So there's some non-trivial transformation that has to be done to take that into account if you want a universal type equation of state. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so in this analysis and these plots, these are both allowed to vary independently, and the prior is flat on this square. It's just outside it's just outside the 50% confidence for this particular waveform. but not for all of them. So it's kind of very marginal, and you wouldn't necessarily say it was truly ruled out. I don't know, actually. That's the aligned spin phenom D with tides, basically. So I'm guessing that the extra freedom in the processing spin case soaks up some of this uncertainty and spreads things out a little bit. Okay, well, there's plenty of gory details in the updated analysis, and also there's a specific paper on the single equation of state that you can also look up if you like. The point I was trying to make, or that I should have made, is that these are difficult parameters to measure. We talked about how they enter into the post-Newtonian formula yesterday. The tidal parameters come in at a very high order, so there's actually not a lot of information there, so the constraints are pretty weak. Okay, moving on. We also looked at sky localization for the binary black holes, and you can see, based on the fact that the effective bandwidth of a binary neutron star system is much larger, this allows the sky location to be constrained much more accurately. The width of the ring, if you like, there's a ring here, which I'll talk about in a minute, is more narrow than it would be for a binary black hole case. And indeed, if you look at the effect of adding Virgo to the network, you can see that that third detector, similar to we saw for 1708-14, is splitting this degeneracy. So if you only analyze this data from the LIGO detectors, you would end up with the light green blobs, but adding in Virgo does indeed constrain it quite nicely to the patch that overlaps with the similar localization from Fermi. And that was what allowed people to then go and search the galaxies inside this narrower error region to find the host there. You can also use the EM information now that if you identify the host galaxy to then go back and inform your measurement of the distance and inclination. So we were talking about the degeneracy in these two parameters there yesterday. And then if you actually are able to go identify the host galaxy, then if you know the redshift of that galaxy and you assume a certain cosmology, then that will give you an estimate of what the distance to the source must have been. And that in turn lets you then constrain the inclination angle by breaking this degeneracy. So you can see we'd have this, again, the two analyses, one with the unconstrained prior, giving you the blue results, which has the familiar degeneracy, and one with this informed distance prior. Limiting the distance distribution in turn takes a slice out of this larger error box and lets you limit the inclination distribution as well. So you get a fairly nice estimate of what the viewing angle of that source would have been, which then you can go and compare to the various different estimates that come from electromagnetic observations of the aftermath of the merger. So they're all kind of narrowing in on somewhere in this range between about 150 and 160 in terms of the EM observations. So the picture of this thing looks fairly consistent, but then there's a lot of model-dependent uncertainty that I'm not really qualified to talk about, so I'll stick to the gravitational wave side. But it's an interesting thing to look into. Okay, so this is the end of the previous lecture. Hopefully now you'll have some understanding of what is driving the results that we've been obtaining from Advanced LIGO and Advanced Virgo, and you will see why, what the physics is that goes in to make them up. We've also looked at how the parameters are related to each other and the various degeneracies and correlations that exist, and that's interesting not just from an observational point of view, but in terms of how we go on to design algorithms that can solve these problems. So we'll look at that in the next lecture. And we've looked at some of the parameter estimation results from the first two observing runs. So hopefully now you'll be able to go and pick up one of these two papers, the either the source properties of the first detection, if you're keen on binary black holes, or one of the the properties of the binary neutron star papers, if you're keen on the binary neutron stars, and you should be able to read it through and get a good grasp of what's going on in getting those results. Okay, so I'll pause there for a minute if there's any questions on the kind of observational side, and then we'll go on to talk about methods for performing parameter estimation. All is clear? Okay, that's good. Right, so the second lecture, I wanted to get a little bit more technical on the side of how we actually do this in practice. So a lot of the arguments that I gave in the first lecture are to aid understanding in terms of the heuristics and looking at the physics. If you want to actually solve the full problem, that can help you. That's certainly an aid in doing it efficiently. But you need to then understand what methods are available to actually do that. So we're going to have a look at those in the remainder of the time today. We have 1 hour, which is probably enough. So we've seen that there are a large number of parameters that actually determine the behavior of the signal. And we want to know now what is the posterior probability distribution on those parameters. That's the object that we're trying to obtain in doing this analysis. So how do we actually do this in practice? And the first thing you have to appreciate is that there is a difference in how you would want to do this depending on what your actual desired result is. So it's, there's a time scale involved. Now, it's very important that we're able to issue rapid alerts for sources that we've detected and allow people to follow them up electromagnetically. So there are algorithms that are specifically targeted at performing rapid localization. You can look at the timescales here from the initial event onwards in a logarithmic type axis between detecting the signal and the data, which takes roughly a few minutes. I think our latency was around 2 to 3 minutes for the detection pipelines in the last observing run. Once you have done the detection, then you can run a rapid localization algorithm on the output of those detection pipelines. And that's something that's designed to take only a few seconds to rapidly make a sky map. And that's what gets sent out as a FITS file, standard data format to observing partners. In the next observing run, this will be available to any member of the public. So we'll be moving on to open public alerts. So if you have a telescope in your back garden, you're very welcome to participate in the follow-up. Or indeed, if you work in an observatory. Now, at the longer time scales, we want to fully get all the details, so all of these parameters, not just the sky location. So we use different methods for doing the full parameter estimation analysis compared to doing the rapid localization. And there's also a kind of a breakdown in timescales between how quickly, how much detail you want to include in those analyses. If you want a fast non-spinning type analysis or an aligned spin analysis, that can be done in a few hours now. I think these timescales have moved down a little bit since this figure was made, thanks to improvements in the code and computers. But then we still have an issue with the slow, fully spinning type analyses that have the best waveforms. They tend to be slow to compute. And so they can take days, weeks even, to obtain a full result. So there's a fair amount of patience involved in actually doing these analyses. And there's still a lot of active research projects available in making these things faster so that we can get the results out quicker. That's going to be especially important when we start detecting tens or more of binary black holes and binary neutron stars. We might actually start running into our computational limits available to the LIGO-Virgo collaboration. So I'm not going to say a huge amount about the rapid localization methods. I can explain roughly what it's doing. The best reference here is the BASE-STAR paper from Leo Singer. The 2014 one explains the algorithm in detail, and then there's a a more recent one that looks at estimating distance as well as sky position. But the general idea is that you fix the intrinsic parameters, the masses and the spins, to whatever was the best fitting template from the detection pipeline. So that allows you to make a sort of best guess given the information that's available immediately. And then you can, having fixed those parameters, ask what are the probability distribution of the remaining extrinsic parameters. So that's the right ascension, declination, polarization, phase, inclination, and luminosity distance. Now, you're not necessarily interested in the phase or the polarization angle or even the inclination angle in low latency. So this method employs a range of tricks to actually marginalize out these parameters that are not of interest, leaving you only with the three-dimensional right ascension, declination, and luminosity distance posterior. And that object is then issued in a rapid alert to the observers. You would get a map of the sky that has a probability in two dimensions, but also an estimator for the mean distance and the standard deviation of that distance at each point in the sky. So you can build a 3D map of the source localization from the low latency information that way. And that map would look something like this. So you tend to get this interesting looking shape where the narrow axis is very narrow because that's set by the timing delays between the detectors. But then you have degeneracy in this direction and also in the luminosity distance direction that will tend to give you results that look something like this. Then what you would do is take a galaxy catalog, look and see what galaxies are living inside this very thin distribution, and then you can go and follow them up individually, or you can try and tile the two-dimensional area. But it's nice that it gives you some depth information as well as just the position in two dimensions. So that's basically essential in order to be able to rapidly localize the counterpart. So that's something that's very well tuned and runs very rapidly. Now moving on to the full parameter estimation, that's what we're going to be talking about for most of the rest of the lecture. This is now looking at exploring the full parameter space. And there are either 9 parameters if you ignore spins, 11 if you have an aligned spin model, 15 if you have the full processing spin, or more if you want to include non-GR or tidal parameters into the model. So this is starting to really blow up the number of dimensions that have to be analyzed to get the full posterior distribution. Now you can quantify what the amount of information is that's in this data. The result is that there are roughly 30 to 40 bits of information about the source, so it's a nice little number to have. Now, you might ask, what does that mean? Well, it means that you would have to, if you divided up your parameter space in an even grid, you would end up with about 2 to the power of 30-ish grid points in order to actually find where the peak is. So this is a pretty large number, and it's not something that you would want to exhaustively test every single point in that space. So we're not able to just do a direct integration, a direct analysis at every point in the parameter space. We could be saved if the signal model was linear, because there exist efficient algorithms for optimizing linear and quadratic likelihood functions. Unfortunately, the gravitational wave model, with all its many, many cycles and its chirping behavior, is not amenable to this sort of treatment directly. Some of the burst techniques, on the other hand, are. So if you have a linear superposition of lots of wavelets, for example, then you could develop an algorithm that took advantage of some of these tricks. But if we're doing the model search with a template, then you can't do that. So what we do is try a stochastic sampling algorithm, which basically the aim is to produce samples from this posterior distribution in the high dimensional space. And then you can look at those samples as a histogram or any other method you want, use them as a Monte Carlo integration to get the posterior in whichever combination of the dimensions that you want. So there's a sort of package that's been developed based on work of many groups on the last 10 years or so that the LIGO Virgo collaboration have been using to do this. It's called LAL Inference, and it's available for free if you want to try and run it yourself on the open data. And it's also hooked into these state-of-the-art waveforms in LAL simulations, so it's kind of internal, able to track the latest developments inside the collaboration. As a collaboration product, it's been reviewed with code review, and it took me a long time to really believe what was coming out of these things. I think as one of the developers, you're probably one of the last people to actually believe the results. But I do actually believe what these things are. And it's nice having verification from the universe in the form of actually being able to go and look where the thing is pointing and see that there is a GRB there. So there's two algorithms that are included in this package. Markov chain Monte Carlo, which is universally called MCMC, and nested sampling algorithm, which are able to do Bayesian parameter estimation and model selection, so solving both halves of the inference problem. I'm going to talk first about parameter estimation, and we'll come back to model selection a bit later on, because the first thing to explain is what is this Markov chain Monte Carlo. So probably people will have heard the name MCMC, but not necessarily have used it or looked into it. But let me give you a very brief introduction. So it's a technique to do what we said we wanted to do, that's draw samples from the posterior distribution. It's actually usable for any target distribution that you like, so it was first developed for doing simulations of annealing and thermodynamics in materials, but it's really caught on in the kind of Bayesian inference world because it can explore these high-dimensional parameter spaces. And it's a sequential algorithm. This is a bit of a bottleneck as far as we're concerned, because it operates on a step-by-step basis. So what you do is you start with a given point that lives somewhere in the parameter space that you're interested in, and you basically start taking a random walk. So you just explore at random initially in what direction you want to go. And when you take a jump, then you evaluate the new likelihood function at the new point. Now, there's a special rule that tells you whether you want to keep the new point or keep the old point instead. And that is called the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm. It gives you this probability ratio of whether you keep the new point or reject it and keep the old point. And it's just the minimum of one, and the ratio of the two distributions that you're trying to sample, one at the new point over one at the old point. But you also have the ratio of the proposal distributions at the new point and the old point. And if you notice, this is inverted, so that you're actually looking at the density of the old point from the new point versus the new point at the old point on the bottom. And there's a reason for that, which is basically that it has to be unbiased. You don't want your proposal to continually push you in one direction. So when you're deciding whether to take a jump or not, you have to correct for the amount that that proposal is trying to push you in a particular direction. So in the case where you have, I can draw it on the board, a very simple situation where the proposal distribution is symmetric, then those two values just cancel out. So if we started here, for example, and we took a jump, we had a proposal distribution that just was some kind of Gaussian, and we ended up taking a jump here, then what you would do is you evaluate what is the probability of making the reverse move divided by the probability of the forward move. So that's this extra ratio here. So it's easy to see that you want to move to areas of higher probability of your target distribution, of your likelihood, because you want to find the peak, but you also have to include this correction for the fact that hopefully you aren't being pushed in any one direction. So if the entire parameter space is accessible in an infinite number of these jumps, so that means that there's no disconnected area in the parameter space that is inaccessible from one place to another. then you can, and also that the proposals are aperiodic and that you're never caught in a loop where you just jump from one back to the other continuously, because obviously that is going to ruin your sampling. Then there's a unique stationary distribution to which this Markov chain converges. So if you take this jump, take another one, and so on, then you'll find that eventually the density of the points that come out from your sampler will indeed match whatever the target distribution is. Oh, I can't even draw it properly. Whatever the target distribution is that you're trying to sample. So ignoring the Hastings part and just looking at the original Metropolis algorithm, it's easy to see why this is. Because if these conditions are met, then it obeys the principle of detailed balance. That means that the overall probability of being at one point and taking a jump to a new point is the same as being at that new point and taking a jump to the previous point. And if you then, it's a very simple calculation to show that if you then marginalize this over all the possible starting points, then the resulting distribution of the new point is indeed the distribution that you were trying to sample in the first place. If you include the Metropolis Hastings and there's a Q factor in there, you have to plug that into the equation, but the proof goes roughly the same way. So I've tried to draw it on the board, but it's easier if you look at a movie. So here's an example of a Markov chain Monte Carlo exploring the mass posterior distribution for a simple low-mass binary black hole. And you can see that what's happening is that initially you start somewhere, just anywhere in the parameter space, and gradually you'll walk closer to the true value, which is represented by the red line. But you don't ever get fixed in a single point. You don't want to get stuck. You want to keep on drawing new points. So you see that even when you've locked onto the general area, the samples are still able to walk around freely inside that blob. And that distribution of samples, the density of the samples at any one point, is then proportional to the density of the distribution you're trying to sample, which is basically the definition of a sample. So let me just play it again so you can see. It takes a little while to find the correct position. That's called the burn-in phase. And then once you're there, it just settles into the stationary distribution. So when you're doing Markov chain Monte Carlo, you have to always remember to chop out the burn-in phase from where you started. Beg your pardon? No? What do you mean wide? Oh, it's just a high resolution. I mean, there's like 100,000 samples on this plot. Indeed. So I didn't actually put in a slide on assessing convergence because there's no general way to do it. So I can't give you a one unique answer, but there are some methods that we do use. So particularly, you know, what we do in practice is we run this multiple times and we check that the resulting distributions that different chains have are consistent with one another. That's a very good way of doing it, because if you start them in different positions, they will end up locking onto different modes if they're not working properly. If they are working properly, then they should be consistent. Another one you can do is look at the evolution of the likelihood values at different points in the chain. And if you find that they're getting stuck, or if they are not, if they're taking a jump up still at some point during the run, then you might want to wait a bit longer before they actually converge. So if you start at a random point, it will have a low log likelihood here, and you will tend to find that it will occasionally take a good jump and lock onto a new position. And once it's locked on, it will never be able to get any higher. So you will, what we will also do is look at how this log likelihood evolves as a function of the iteration. There's also some heuristics for looking at the distribution of the log likelihood when you're taking the random walk and drawing samples from the posterior. then the amount that it goes below the maximum, if you like, some limit here, okay, the way I've drawn it is not strictly accurate. There's some limit that's roughly equal to the maximum likelihood minus the number of dimensions divided by 2, that if everything was nice and Gaussian, for example, then you can show that it would rarely fall below this point. So you can do this kind of checks, and then there are other things like Gelman-Rubin tests and so on, but you'd have to read a textbook about MCMC methods if you wanted to get all the latest. Yeah? Sure. Yeah, so we're sampling the posterior distribution. I should say log posterior.
So where are the, is it in these P's and Q's you mentioned on the previous slide, is that where our theory is and our models for what's coming out of this? Or?
It's in the P's, not in the Q's. So the Q is the internal, where is it? The Q is how you jump from one point to another, and the P is the thing that you're trying to sample. So a lot of the, you know, the difficulty in actually doing this basically comes down to picking a cue that works well, or picking a combination of different cues that work well for the problem that you have. So for example, something that's quite difficult to do, if you try and code this up naively, say you had a log posterior that had two peaks in it, like this. What is the scale for that Q jump that is optimal for this problem? Well, you, for a start, you don't know that there are two peaks before you solve the problem, so that's always a trick. But if you want to sample one of these peaks, then the correct scale to get the best acceptance ratio and the most independent samples is something that's on the order of the width of this peak itself. So you would end up, if you did some basic tuning without knowing there was another peak, you would end up with a jump proposal. Well, arbitrary parameter and log, well, likelihood, yeah, or posterior. So your jump proposal, say you were started here, your jump proposal may say, okay, my new step should be somewhere in this distribution. So you might say, okay, I drew it, let's end up here. And indeed, there's a good value of the probability there, so it takes the jump, which is what you want. You want it to be accepting the jumps as often as possible so that the chain is mixing well. But if you only have this jump scale, then the chances of making a jump into this mode are vanishingly small. So you need to have some combination of jumps or in a way of adaptively tuning this jump proposal that will let you take steps of the right size. So every once in a while, you might want to do a giant leap over here instead of just trying to sample the mode. But then, of course, you don't really know where is that other mode until you've solved the problem. So you end up with some leap length scale that could be absolutely enormous compared to the size of the problem that you like. And it's only when you hit that sweet spot of the mode separation that it's ever going to have any real effect. So, you know, it's a bit of a thorny issue, and that's why it's important to understand the structure of the problem that you're trying to deal with, because then you have some idea of where these length scales are. Okay. So I'd say it's guaranteed to converge eventually. If you wait an infinitely long amount of time, you will take a jump over here, and then you'll be fine. And then you'll wait another infinitely long amount of time, you'll take another jump back over, and you'll be fine. But that's really not good enough for any human. So the problem is basically, how do you find the efficient jump proposals to use when you're doing MCMC for gravitational wave analysis? So these algorithms that we've been using are been evolving over years to take advantage of some of these sort of various techniques and to explore the correlations and the degeneracies that we looked at in the last lecture. So we sort of have hand-tuned jump proposals that can explore the distance inclination degeneracy and can look at the different other degeneracies. And I'll show you a couple of them in a minute. And of course, we don't use a single jump proposal. We actually have multiple different jump proposals and reparameterizations that can be used to solve the problem. So reparameterization and jump proposals, you can think of them as sort of two sides of the same coin. The chirp mass chirp mass and mass ratio posterior. Now we've seen that these are ridiculously narrow in the chirp mass direction and quite wide in the mass ratio direction. So you wouldn't want to use M1 and M2 as your sampling parameters here, because any jump proposal that you have that's naive, if it started on this blob, unless it knows about this direction, then it's going to end up jumping somewhere outside the blob and it'll never end up getting accepted. So you can have a jump proposal that knows about the direction, that has the specific chirp mass baked into it, or you can transform the problem into a new set of parameters where the posterior is something a bit more separable. So the first thing that we do is use the chirp mass and the mass ratio instead of M1 and M2. We haven't actually implemented the extension of this to explore the degeneracy between the mass ratio and chi effective, which is an obvious thing to do. So there's a problem there if anyone's keen on working on this topic. So when we're exploring the Q and chi effective, the degeneracy isn't quite so bad, but still it's something that could be improved. Another one that we looked at yesterday is the sky location. So we know that the time delay information is the dominant information in localizing a source. And if you take a pair of detectors and separate them on the Earth, and you know the delay time between the two of them, then you will find that there's a ring of allowed positions that are consistent with that particular time delay. Where did I put the eraser? Can everyone see the board? Or, oh no, the lights are on. No, they're not on. Do you want me to turn the light on? I'll draw big. So if I have Livingston and Hanford, for example, then a wave that's coming in a particular direction will have some phase here and some phase there. And from that, you will be able to say, well, the angle between the direction of propagation and this angle and this vector that separates the two detectors must be such and such. But there's a ring that's consistent with that angle, of course, that lets you, maintain the timing in the two detectors. So you tend to see these features in the posterior that look like rings. And we saw them in the localization diagrams. I'm showing you here a kind of scan through the likelihood function, where the low values are low. The red values are low likelihoods, green intermediate, and then the actual peak is there. And this shows you kind of nicely that there is this ring structure that's buried. It's broken in the case of three detectors. It's a broken degeneracy, but it does still exist at lower values of the likelihood. And that gets mixed up also with the time of arrival of the source. So you have to also estimate that. You choose the time in the geocenter as your parameter, normally. But then if you vary the position of the source, then the geocenter is somewhere over here. So the time it takes the wave to travel between these detectors and the geocenter is a function of where on this ring it's coming in from. So that induces another degeneracy between the sky position, in this case I've got the rate ascension and the end time of the source in the geocenter. So what you have to do, you can have a jump proposal that goes around the ring, that's what we used to do, or you can do a reparameterization into a different coordinate system. Which is actually somewhat more effective. Because if you take into account this correlation, then you'll notice that what you want to do is keep these two times fixed. And then you know that if you just change your spherical coordinate basis so that this is now the North Pole, if you like, then the parameter in the new, the posterior in the new parameter space will actually end up being pretty much separable. So if this is this angle theta on the y-axis, let's say, and we'll give it another angle phi going around here, then this ring, which previously is quite complicated to sample, just becomes a very nice separable 2D rectangular distribution. Now, add in also the time of arrival at one of the detectors, and you have a unique transformation from the old sky position to the new coordinates. So these days, we just use these detector fixed coordinates to sample the ring. But that doesn't work quite so well in three dimensions. So in 3D, three detectors. So in 3D, you've got three pairs of rings, and they will intersect at two different points on the celestial sphere. You can see this. This is the best diagram I had readily available. There are three rings here. They're broken for each of the pairs of detectors. So Livingston Virgo gives you something that's kind of here, but it's not likely to lie in this section, so there's no samples. Hanford Livingston gives you the small one here. Hanford Virgo gives you a large blue one here. And you can see that these three intersect at two points, one here where the source is actually located, but they're also going to intersect over here. It's not visible on the diagram, but there is another intersection point between these three rings. So what you want to do then is create a jump proposal that flips over between one of those intersection points and the other. So there's a nice paper that explores how to do that and also keep the amplitudes consistent that Vivian Raymond was the lead author of. And just to basically give you the idea, you can solve the set of equations for describing the position and the amplitude for these two different points. Because it's interesting, if you have Hanford, Livingston, and Virgo, like so, if you were to draw a plane that contained those three detectors, then now you have a source that's over here, has some incident angle to the plane, and if you want to keep the timing the same in those three detectors, now you don't have a ring anymore, but you've got the opposite point down here. So the secondary peak here is just a reflection of the primary in the plane that contains the three detectors. Now, once you make that jump, you keep the timing the same, but you change the amplitudes because the detectors are not aligned with this plane. Like, their response functions are in no way dependent on, you know, exactly this timing plane. So you have to update your distance and your inclination and your polarization angle so that you can make the correct jump that preserves the amplitudes observed in the two detectors. So this paper here solves those equations and lets you do that in a nice, efficient way. Another example is the spin parameters. I said a little bit about this yesterday. If you have precessing spins, then the orbital angular momentum is not a good parameter to use because it precesses around the total angular momentum vector. So the obvious thing to do there is give up on the orbital angular momentum and just use the total angular momentum vector instead. So if you look at any of the results that we present, we usually write theta jn instead of inclination, which is the angle between the line of sight and that total angular momentum vector rather than the inclination itself. This picture shows you kind of the extent of the issue here. The blue is the theta jn angle throughout the evolution of a precessing orbit, and the black line is the inclination angle throughout that evolution. So you can see that this one oscillates quite wildly. However, theta jn is approximately conserved through the whole process. So that is a huge boost for being able to do the precessing spin analysis. That's basically essential if you want to do that efficiently. There's also complementary parameters in the system frame itself. The spin magnitudes, the tilt angles, and then the two remaining angles, you separate the difference in the azimuthal angle between spin 1 and spin 2, and the difference in the azimuthal angle between the total angular momentum and the and the orbital angular momentum. So that's another trick that's baked into Lal inference. Another thing you can do is try and reduce the dimensionality of the problem, because that's going to make it easier to explore the parameter space. So a good thing to do here is if you can analytically marginalize out some of the parameters, then you're not losing any information about the ones that you're interested in, but you're still able to accelerate your solution. So the really easy one is the phase, where if you remember our initial likelihood function had this inner product of the data with itself. Wait, how am I writing it in this thing? Yeah. So okay, I'm abusing my notation a little bit. This is the inner product. These are also modulus inner products. So here what you would say is, well, if you have a signal that has only the L equals M equals 2 mode, then you can write it as some reference signal times a phase, e to the I phi, and bring that phase outside the inner product. So you end up with a term that's like this. And now this is the log likelihood, remember. So if you want to do this integral, it turns out there's a nice standard form you can use that gives you a Bessel function in terms of the inner product, rather than an exponential, which is what you have normally. So this is actually, it buys you a dimension in terms of getting rid of the phase, which is not that big a deal because the phase is not well measured. But the fact that you no longer have a phase to worry about accelerates the entire process, because it smooths out the distribution in any of the other dimensions as well. If you want to get more advanced, you can do the same kind of process over time and phase at the same time with the fast Fourier transform method. That is no longer analytic, but it's semi-analytic method that basically corresponds to evaluating this function at each point in a time delay using an FFT. And also distance marginalization. This is implemented now, but still in testing. And it's based on the same technique that Baystar uses when it does its distance marginalization with a lookup table. And that is, seems to have a huge effect on the performance of the code by getting rid of a particularly troublesome dimension. Okay, I am kind of running out of time, so let's move on. There's a few extensions to MC algorithm that have been used. In Lal inference, we're using parallel tempering, which is another way of being able to hop between modes. So these are these two peaks that I drew in the sketch, and you don't know where they are, and so you can't efficiently jump between them in separation space. But what you can do is raise the likelihood function to some inverse temperature, power of an inverse temperature, and that's going to reduce the dynamical range of the function. So instead of having these two sharp peaks, you're going to end up with something that's a lot more smooth. And that becomes much easier for an MCMC to walk around in. So then what you have is multiple chains that are running with different temperature factors. And then you can jump, swap values between the chains, and that allows you to mix more freely across the parameter space. Then you can improve on that further by looking at an adaptive method for setting the temperature scales. There's a paper that came from Will Vousden that explains how this is done in practice. But you can see that eventually this also converges and you end up with a very efficient parallel tempering sampler. Another popular method is an ensemble sampling method. This is what MC uses, if anyone's used that package. And it has a nice trick in that it involves a collection of samples instead of just a single point. So you take your sequential MCMC algorithm, but you're applying it now to many different points in parallel. And because you get lots of samples at any one step in the parameter space, then you can use that information to try and come up with an efficient jump proposal based on that current information. So the two that it uses in particular are what's called stretch move, where you start here, you pick another point that's currently active, and say, well, I want to just move in that direction by some factor. Now you draw the factor from a random distribution, and end up making a walk in that direction. And you can imagine that's going to tend to move you closer to where the other points are and give you a better acceptance ratio. And likewise, there's a similar thing that's based on the walk move, where you can build a polygon out of multiple points or an n-gon in higher dimensions, and then take jumps inside that region. This is also useful for the nested sampling method that I'm now going to move on to, because that inherently evolves a collection of points at the same time. So these jump proposals are also used in that case as well. So I mentioned nested sampling. The real purpose of nested sampling is not to do parameter estimation, but rather to do model selection. So here we have two different models, and you want to evaluate the marginal evidence, the marginal likelihood of each of them. And the ratio of those two marginal likelihoods is just giving you the base factor. That's the odds in favor of model A over model B, for example. Now, the nested sampling algorithm is basically based on a geometric shrinkage of the samples in the parameter space. So it's a mapping from your n-dimensional parameter space, where there's some probability distribution that you're interested in, onto a one-dimensional space, where the value is the fraction of the prior that's enclosed by a contour. So for each sample, say this one, you have a contour that has the same likelihood. But you don't know where that contour is exactly. But you know that it must enclose some fraction of the total prior volume of the problem. So that contour here maps to this point here in the parameter space. Now, if I throw away this point and pick another one that has a higher likelihood value, then I know that that contour that that point lives on must lie inside the previous one. And so the ratio of the volume of this one to this one, and this one to the total volume, remains roughly the same. And so you proceed onwards, and if you keep on multiplying the volume enclosed by a number less than one, then you're actually performing a geometric shrinkage of these contours. So eventually, no matter what the scale is of the problem that you're trying to address, it will converge on the peak. I'm not going to talk about the maths because we don't have time. Now, the clever bit in the algorithm is, how do you know what that volume is? Because you don't want to have to compute the full contour, because that would basically involve exploring the entire space and drawing a map and doing a search, looking at derivatives. So what it does instead is it takes a probabilistic method of doing that. So you know that if you have a fixed number of samples and you sort them into ascending order of likelihood or descending order of likelihood, then there's a distribution for what the minimum value in that collection is. So say you have n points, n live points in the terminology of nested sampling, then the shrinkage factor is this t parameter, and it's roughly equal to the expectation value of the log as minus the number of live points to the minus one. So if you increase the number of live points, you get a better sampling of that distribution, and you can target a certain accuracy that you want to in terms of the evidence. That's probably not a great explanation, but we don't have time to go into it. So if anyone wants to know more, you can ask me later, but I'll let you get the general idea by showing you a movie. So this is the geometric shrinkage that I'm talking about. These are the live points, the currently active ones, and you can see they're moving to a higher likelihood on the y-axis. And as they're doing so, the actual position of those points in the parameter space is starting to get more and more constrained to where the true value is. And you can see this is mapping out all those degeneracies that we were talking about a minute ago. So you do that for a compact binary signal and map out what is the fraction of the prior that's occupied by a certain likelihood value. Well, it's interesting to look at what that is. So for some fiducial signals, these are an SNR of roughly 15, you can see binary neutron stars have most of their likelihood concentrated at a smaller fraction of the prior compared to a binary black hole system. And that's telling us what we already know from our heuristic algorithm arguments yesterday, that binary neutron stars are harder to find than binary black holes. They require a more computational effort. Now, once you've done your search, you might want to check what the results are like. So I'll talk briefly about consistency checks. A very powerful one that we really rely on in doing our code review is if you were to inject 100 signals, say, that were sampled from the prior that you want that you've set in your code, then if your program is working correctly, then 5% of the signals should fall within the fifth percentile of the probability distribution in the recovery, and so on and so forth for the 50%, 90%, and so on. And if you plot then the fraction of the signals that are found within a certain confidence region, that should trace out a nice diagonal line in this P versus P plot. I highly recommend if you ever have a problem that you're using MCMC to tackle, that you do a sanity check of this type to make sure that you're actually recovering results that are consistent with what you think they are. It's a good one to catch things where if your code is not exploring things well enough, it will tend to over-concentrate the posterior. So you'll end up with a model that looks like that when the real one maybe looks like this. And it would be difficult to tell just from the value of the peak that you're doing stuff wrong, because the peak value is correct. But the width, which would show up the error in the width estimate on this plot, because you would tend to find that there are more points outside a certain region than you would expect. Okay, so I'll talk about the method. This is a costly algorithm. All of these methods are costly. The reason for that is that you have to end up, basically, I've done it for the nested sampling algorithm. You have multiple iterations in each of the iterations of the chain. Every time you do that, you run a little MCMC. That has to compute a likelihood, which involves computing one of these inner products. And in order to compute the inner product, you need to know what the template is that you're looking at. So you have to generate a template as well. And actually, there's a multiplicative factor in each of these cases in the naive application. And this is the most expensive step in the whole process. So you're totally limited by the cost of generating templates in practice. So really what we're looking for from waveform modelers is something that's ridiculously fast to let us do a quick likelihood evaluation. There's different ways of doing that. You can have a method that's inherently simple in terms of the physics that encapsulates. Or you can build something like an approximate model, a surrogate model that approximates one of the waveforms based on pre-calculations. And likewise, you have ways of approximating the likelihood surface itself using reduced order quadrature. So there you're replacing this integral over the frequency bins with an integral over a different basis that you pre-compute based on the data that you have. So there's some references there that you can investigate if you're interested in any of these applications later. There's different ways that you can do it. You can parallelize different stages. So you can run lots of things, many times. You can run these things in parallel. You can try and parallelize your likelihood calculation. Or even your template calculation if it's of an analytic form. You can in principle parallelize any one of these steps, but the overall algorithm itself is serial, so you're limited sort of running multiple chains. Why is this suddenly frozen up? Shouldn't have left that MCMC running in the background. Okay, let me just say very briefly about systematics. This is another big problem that we have to address. Calibration errors are a particular one. This is where you never know exactly what the response of the detector is, so you have to approximate the functional form of that response. That is now baked into our analyses, so that this is included with some extra uncertainty in the results. The templates themselves are not perfect. They don't always include all the physics. So there are different methods that have looked at trying to correct that using things like Gaussian processes. There's a reference there if you're interested. Also, the power spectral density estimation is never exactly correct. So the noise floor can vary over the time that you're using to estimate what a PhD is. So ideally you would like some estimator that doesn't depend on additional data, and there are methods to do that. And likewise, the model might not be well described by stationary noise. That was the fundamental problem that we talked about yesterday. It's highlighted particularly in the case of the BNS, where there was a whopping great glitch right in the middle of the signal. So there we had to manually remove that by fitting it out with a damped sine Gaussian. But there are algorithmic ways of trying to do that at the same time, and I think Neil, who's lecturing next week, might tell you a bit about the Bayes wave algorithm that attempts to do that. Although I think he's talking about Lisa, so probably not. Pulsar timing, okay, he does a lot of things. Right, so there's a few ongoing developments in this area. There's always investigation of more efficient serial algorithms. One that's particularly interesting is the Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, which basically uses a Hamiltonian formalism where the log likelihood corresponds to energy. But in order to do that, you're following Hamiltonian paths. You need to know then the derivatives of the log likelihood. So you would want some way of computing them directly rather than taking derivatives of waveforms. There are parallel MCMC methods that involve multiple chains. For example, the Combine Sampler, or MC, I think, also uses multiple cores. You have also hybrid and exhaustive search algorithms, where part of the problem is addressed in an exhaustive manner, and that can be easily parallelized, and then the rest is done using a Monte Carlo algorithm. For example, the Pankow method that's been used in some of our publications, and Ian Harry's method that takes a similar looking approach. And we're also working on making the code more accessible, moving it from C to a Python base. So a lot of you will have used PyCBC or GWIN, and this will gradually supplant the old code in a way to get people more involved in doing the analysis. And I should also say, I can't end this talk by saying that yesterday we released many of the posterior samples from the O1 binary black hole events. So you can download them from the LIGO Document Control Center here. Just write down that number and you can go on and search for it. And we also have the ones from the binary neutron star as well, of course. Now, those are the actual samples that we used in to make the papers, and there's some example notebooks involved there as well. And I'm going to actually show you an example of that in the 5 remaining minutes of how you might use that. Because I want to talk very briefly about hierarchical modeling, because we'd look at parameter estimation as something of making nice plots that helps you understand the uncertainty in the results, but that can also be used as an input to the next level of some analysis. So if you have multiple sources, say, and you want to infer some parameter that describes the population of those sources or some common parameter of those sources, then you would do some form of a hierarchical analysis. So for example, you could do a test of general relativity where there's some deviation from the waveform that GR predicts and you want to try and constrain it with lots of events, or the neutron star equation of state, which is kind of the same basic thing. And here you see that the number of events, as that increases, you end up with narrower and narrower results that converge on the desired value. So you're kind of stacking events or using the information from multiple events at the same time. Then there are the kind of analyses where you have a population and you want to know what are the shape of that population. So it could be the overall rate, which is a simple analysis, or it could be the mass function or the spin distribution of binary black holes, looking whether they're aligned or isotropic, for example. In all of these things, it's important to remember that the events that you see are not all the events that are out there. So there are some selection function that's based, it's giving you a biased sample of the population. So a lot of the actual detailed work in doing these analyses comes into working out what that selection function is. A nice example of this is the parameterized test of GR from the O1 binary black hole events. So you can see here, these are different post-Newtonian orders and deviations in each of them that are allowed by the data. And you get the short signal GW50914 is quite good at constraining the high PN orders, whereas the longer signal GW151226 is better at constraining the low PN orders because they have a longer time to take effect. So you put these together and you end up with an overall constraint that has, you know, the low, the best bits of both, in other words. I can say that very briefly how you would actually do this in practice. This is where the posterior samples come in. Because what you want to do is take, now we're talking about multiple events. So if this is signal number I, and there's some global parameter gamma that you were trying to estimate, you want the likelihood of that signal I given, you know, your global parameter. And you just end up doing the same kind of trick that we looked at in the first place of taking the product of these likelihood functions over all of the different events. Now, each of the events has lots of nuisance parameters, which are theta in my description here. And what you would have to do is then integrate them out individually. And that leaves you just with the global parameter gamma. But you can do that in a nice way using the posterior samples that I've been describing. Because what this now you'll see is the expectation value of this function under this distribution. And this distribution is exactly what the posterior samples are from. So one way to do this integral, and therefore take the product, is just to take the expectation value of your hierarchical model evaluated at the values for the individual events. So I've got 4 minutes to do this, so I'm just going to run the notebook. I thought I would show you an example of this because it was asked about yesterday, especially when it comes to the priors. This was something I just did this afternoon, so apologies if it doesn't work properly. Okay. Go to page. Oh, go away. That's weird. Anyway, here's the notebook. So this is an example of a hierarchical analysis where I'm using those public O1 black hole posteriors. And I'm just going to try and answer the question, are those black holes, are there tilts of the spins, are they aligned with the orbital angular momentum, or are they just isotropically distributed all over the place? And I'm going to pick two models. One is isotropic, which is, has no parameters because there's nothing to choose there except the individual events. And the other one is, I'm saying they are aligned, but they're aligned inside a certain angle. So if I draw the sphere of the spin vectors, I'm saying that if this is aligned, then they're allowed to live inside some parameter T max, some angle there. But I don't know what T max is, so I'm going to estimate that as part of the hierarchical model. So let's just run through this and then we'll end for the day. You can also download this notebook from my website, or I can give it to you if you bump into me in the corridor. Okay, so first of all, we start by a bunch of imports. Here we're just loading in the posterior samples, so that'll take a minute. There's some documentation that's basically describing what I said in words in the form of text. So if it wasn't clear what I said, then maybe you can have a look at that. And it also explains why you can do this using the posterior samples in the first place. Okay, but that's not very interesting, so let's look at some plots. So first of all, let's look at what the data is on the tilt angles. So here I'm just making a plot of the probability density of the tilt angle of the first mass, so the heavier of the two masses for each of the signals. And you can see GW 1509-14, oh wait, which one's which, is green. GW 1512-26, that's the one where it was slightly more constrained, is in the red. Purple is the LVT event, and the blue is the prior, so that's the prior that is assumed by our analysis. Now what I have to do if I want to do a hierarchical analysis is define the likelihood function for the different models that I'm trying to evaluate. And the first one, the isotropic one, H0, has no parameters. So it just takes in those tilt angles and returns some number based on them. The second one has a one parameter, which is T max. So this thing is actually now a hierarchical model where there's a higher order, a global parameter, or what we would call, I've forgotten what you would call it. So this T max is something that we're going to have to integrate out if we want to know the marginal likelihood, the evidence of that model. However, this is just another simple function. I'm using the fact that these both have the form of the prior, but one of them has a certain limit, so only the normalization constant really changes. So what I can do is I can test this out. First of all, to check that they give the same result. Oh, okay, that's a cell I should have deleted. Now we can plot the likelihood of this Tmax parameter as it's updated by these three events. So let's have a look at the plot. So I can ask, what is Tmax based on this data? So the first event I feed in is GW15914, and it ends up giving you some estimate of Tmax that looks a bit like this. There's some weird oscillation here. This is due to the normalization, and this is due to, I think, just the low number of samples at this point. 15, 12, 26, it favors lower values because that's where the posterior and the tilt is, and LVT 15, 10, 12 has almost no information in it, so it doesn't give you a lot of result on that. But then I can multiply those likelihood functions together, as I said in the previous slide, and get a global result. So what is the maximum tilt angle of these binary black holes? Well, this is what the data is telling us. It's this purple curve. So it's not a particularly strong function. It's not like there's a lot of information there. But there is some structure based on the observed data. That's all well and good, but I wouldn't believe that that was meaningful. So what I'm going to do is integrate out that T parameter and give you the evidence for that model. So I can just do that very simply with a sum in this case. So the evidence for the model where there's a fixed maximum tilt is 0.05-ish in this example, whereas the evidence for the isotropic model is 0.125. So then I just compute the ratio of those two probabilities, and I get what's called the Bayes factor, and that's basically telling you, is the data favoring one model over the other? And in this case, it's favoring the isotropic model more than the Tmax model, but by a small factor. So the Bayes factor here is about 0.5. That means the odds are only roughly 2-to-1 in favor of the isotropic model. So there's not a lot of information about the tilts in this O1 data set, which basically is repeating what I said earlier on, that those are difficult parameters to measure. So you really need a kind of smoking gun in order to say something about those. So that should, I mean, hopefully give you the idea of how you can use these data sets in your own work if you're trying to do astrophysical modeling that involves binary black holes or binary neutron stars. Okay, so that is basically the end of the lecture, and I think I've run over time, so we'll end there with the summary. So hopefully you've learned something in the last 2 days about what parameter estimation is, what is the meaning of the results, how they are obtained, and what possible applications you can then take those results onwards to do in your own work. Thank you. Sorry for running over. Yeah. Well, the problem is that the Fisher matrix varies from place to place. So it does work if you have a non-curved parameter space. But the mass space, for example, is curved, so it doesn't really work. Someone else had a hand up? Exactly. So you have to correct for the fact that the samples were obtained using some prior, and you basically have the ratio of the prior from the hierarchical model to the prior that was assumed when doing the analysis. So you're dividing out the original prior and then multiplying by the prior of the hierarchical model. So you do need to know what that is. It can if the sampling isn't great. Like if your priors are very, very different, then you might not have a good sampling of the high prior region of the hierarchical model. But for most of these things, they're, you know, at least at the moment, they're pretty weakly varying functions. So it's not something we've run into in practice just yet. Okay. Well, I guess thank you for listening. I hope you've learned something.